Myopia, an IMAX world. Ken Suedo is an engineer working in military service to his country. He employs the same accuracy and precision in telling his story as he does to maintaining FA-18 jet fighter planes. One of Dr. Price's first patients, Ken recalls those early days when the office was small and the receptionist was the surgeon's mom. Since then, the practice has grown substantially, and Ken has become a faithful supporter of the foundation that Dr. Price began in 1988. Ken's story illustrates the life-changing power that is possible when a skilled surgeon, an innovative method, and a patient's positive attitude are combined. I was born in Chicago and living there when I became severely and suddenly myopic. I was in the third grade at the time. I started wearing thick glasses and became consistently more nearsighted with each passing year. My visual deterioration finally leveled off in high school. By then, I was wearing heavy glasses, which were really unattractive. I also had light-sensitive eyes, and so I had to wear photochromic darkening lenses. These glasses were not made in any fashionable styles either, so that didn't help my general appearance any. Sports were difficult, and so I gravitated toward chess and became a good player. I was more comfortable with things I could get my arms around than with physical outdoor activities taking place 50 yards down a field. With my condition, images were always distorted. I naturally saw things smaller. When I got up in the morning, I had to grab the clock and put it in front of my face, for example, in order to see the time. When I got into college, I started wearing soft contact lenses. I had some additional problems because with my strong prescription, not all contacts were made in the strength I needed. I also have tight eyelids, so the contacts would actually irritate my eyes because the lenses would drift up in the eyelid. The more irritation, the more they grabbed, and a snowball effect would kick in. I also had a bad experience with a new type of wafer-thin lens advertised as 24-hour lenses that you never took out. They tended to really dry my eyes out, and it felt like sandpaper in my eyes each morning. To make a long story short, after 6 months, I just couldn't wear them anymore and went back to wearing glasses. A new young doctor and a promising new procedure. I first met Dr. Price through stories about him in the newspaper, on radio, and TV. I remember quite vividly how the newspaper and TV stories made me feel intrigued and excited. Back then, it was not like today when everyone does laser surgery and it's ho-hum. At that time, he was the only one performing a groundbreaking surgical procedure called myopic keratomalusis. This is a method of reshaping the corneal surface to change its optical power to correct extreme refractive errors, especially nearsightedness like I had. A disc of the cornea is shaved off, quickly frozen, lathe ground, and then returned to its original position. The procedure was first developed in the 60s by a Colombian doctor, I believe, and then brought to Indy by Dr. Price. It was cutting edge. Dr. Price was definitely someone I wanted to meet and talk to about this new procedure. The surgery sounded like an answer to my dreams that could correct my vision. The highest expectation I hoped for was that I would be able to get out of thick glasses and into thin ones. I thought if I could come out of the operation with 20/40 vision, I would be thrilled. When I called Dr. Price's office for an informational meeting, I met with a man named Rick Cadell in a very small office. I also got to meet Dr. Price's mother, Marion, because she was the receptionist. Rick was a senior assistant to the doctor and a fantastic teacher, very knowledgeable. He really helped answer my questions, and I had a lot of them. In fact, later on, Rick would say that I had more questions than all of the other patients combined. We discussed the surgical risks, the possibility of failure, the expenses. He was very honest and never put any pressure on me to make a decision. Now keep in mind, this was when Dr. Price was a young doctor just starting to build his practice. There was a lot of competition in the city, and it would have been easy and understandable for Rick to push me into having the surgery. Instead, he remained caring, attentive, and respectful of my decision-making process. I took my time and weighed the information carefully. When I subsequently met with Dr. Price, I found him to have an extremely good manner. He was candid, described the procedure in detail, and patiently answered my questions. In fact, he was as detail-oriented as I was, and that was great. I'm an engineer, and technical skills matter as much as knowledge in my field. Dr. Price had this quiet self-confidence about him, and he had a great track record of successful procedures. He told me that a laser method had already been envisioned to bring about the same results, but he wasn't sure when it would be introduced or how good the results would be. I spoke with several of his patients who had already had the procedure, and they gave me candid feedback that was very useful. After processing all the information I had learned, I decided to go ahead with it. The surgery. Before the procedure was done, I took a battery of tests that measured the eye from a number of angles to ensure optimal results. Dr. Price was very thorough. The surgery was performed on one eye at a time. Each procedure took 4 to 6 months to really heal. In my case, we opted to do the left eye, my worst eye, first. I was put under while he put a shot behind my eye to immobilize it and to deaden it so that it wouldn't move. He then put a ring on the eye to hold it in place. He took a special surgical blade and cut across the corneal surface to flatten the surface. Then he took the part he had cut off, flash froze it, and put it on a cryo lathe, a computer-controlled machine, to recut the piece and remove tissue on each side. Then it was unfrozen and sutured back onto the eye. It's pretty unbelievable how intricate and perfect the sutures were. I could have stared at them for hours if I'd been given access to a photo of them. They were in a star pattern throughout the eye, and it was really an incredible image. My first surgery was a perfect surgery, a bullseye result. It took 2 hours to prepare for surgery, and then 1 hour for the actual procedure, and another 1.5 hours to recover and be sent home with a patch and a small metal shield to protect the eye. The next day, I came in for an exam, followed by weekly exams, and then gradually monthly visits. During this time, I had an antibiotic cream to apply to prevent infection from developing, and I also had to sleep upright. Soon after surgery, I was able to resume normal activities, including driving, and eventually I had the patch removed but kept the metal guard on at night while sleeping. The improvement was gradual over 4 to 5 months' time, but my vision was improved to 20/15. It far exceeded my expectations. I could see better than I ever could before with either glasses or contact lenses. One unexpected outcome was that everything I could see now so clearly seemed huge. Even my eyes themselves felt huge to me, like watermelons. It felt like I was seeing things in a giant IMAX world. It took me a while to get adjusted to the sensation. Dr. Price was patient and didn't hurry to do the other eye. He wanted to be sure there were no complications, so we waited about 9 months. The only side effect I experienced, besides the sense of having huge eyes, was a moderate amount of haze and afterglow in my night vision. I could see a kind of halo around headlights or streetlights, but eventually this disappeared. We repeated the operation on my other eye, and while the results were very good, they were not perfect as my first one had been. I became a little less farsighted with astigmatism, and I have since had some regression with my first eye, so now I'm nearsighted. But it worked out fine. In fact, sometimes this result is intentionally pursued in order to help patients have balanced vision. I use the right eye for distance and my left eye for close-ups, and I won't have to wear bifocals or reading glasses when I get older. How life has changed. I see more clearly now and without the thick, heavy, cumbersome glasses I had to wear before. I'm not a vain person, but it's nice to be like other people. My interests and my personality have gradually moved outward, and I have pursued new outdoor activities and reached out to more people. I feel like I have a better connectivity with the outside world, and in that sense, my world has expanded. I am grateful for that. As an engineer, I respect the new techniques that modern medicine and science are constantly developing that add to our quality of life. We have to be open to these discoveries and to doctors who are doing cutting-edge work. It would be so much easier for a doctor, once they get that medical degree, to just go with the flow and not do what's more difficult or challenging. We're very lucky that people like Dr. Price are around who are willing to take the lead. There's a heck of a lot of others, I'm sure, who stand on his shoulders for the research he's done since 1988. I know he and his wife, Marianne Price, Ph.D., both have good, strong scientific backgrounds, and they make sure that what they do is repeatable, measurable, and can be used to help people. All progress is usually a succession of small steps, and as long as you make each of these steps strong, there will be advances. Advice to readers. From my personal standpoint, I think you should be aware that obstacles can be overcome by radical change. Be open to that. Choose your surgeon very carefully. Check their credentials and experience and the equipment that they use. It might be tough for laymen to do, but you really have to conduct your own research. Carefully weigh risks and benefits. Check out the options you have during surgery and afterwards. Ask questions. Develop a plan for all contingencies. Be prepared for everything. Knowledge takes away the unknown and the fear of the unknown. If you decide to go ahead, remember that a positive attitude is also very important to deal with the procedure. A positive attitude can definitely influence the result, according to the anecdotal evidence I've read. I draw my own strength and courage from maintaining a positive attitude and accepting the support of family and friends and the doctor and his staff. I also draw strength from knowledge and understanding. Be patient after the surgery. There is a period of fluctuation in vision, and the final result may not be known for some time. It's not like laser surgery where you have a rapid result. Avoid unrealistic expectations. Be positive, but realize that nothing is ever promised. Everything you will achieve is a bonus. You wouldn't go into the operation unless you had positive expectations, but don't expect perfection. Some things are unavoidable, short and long term, and you just have to face them. In closing, I'd like to extend my thanks to Dr. Price and to Robin, his assistant, and his staff in the surgery center, for what they did for me back in the mid-80s, and for the contributions Dr. Price is making to the field of ophthalmology. I think some people are researchers and others are practitioners. Dr. Price is a hybrid. He's both. His perspective is unique, and the synergy is wonderful. His patients benefit from the research, and sometimes they directly participate in it. Vision is a great gift, and most people take it for granted. If you have ever been threatened with the loss of your vision, that casual attitude changes in a hurry. You quickly appreciate the work being done by people like Dr. Price and the Foundation to help patients that they are in contact with, as well as many others. His work touches other doctors who read his research, and then they use it to advance their own work. Eventually, it helps untold patients, people who may never meet Dr. Price or even know his name. I'm just really glad he has the energy to do it all. I could not. At the end of the day, I am done. He's working a lot of hours, I know, and he works hard, so I appreciate all of his achievements. For one person, he has accomplished a lot already, and that is an inspiring message for the rest of us.